Hey folks, welcome to No Tech Talk with Barb, and that's K-N-O-W, tips, advice, and consulting from your business's IT department. I'm your host, Barb Pluskowicz, and for those of you taking notes, Pluskowicz is spelled the exact way it sounds, Pluskowicz. Trust and verify on our website, cdntechnologies.com. If you are thinking about selling your IT company, chances are you've come full circle. The majority of MSPs are tech turn owner operators that grew a respectable business and are now done and want out. They can now take that long overdue vacation, treat themselves to something nice and pretty, perhaps pay back that line of credit, and finally have some real money in the bank as they think about retirement and what they're going to do next. And as a buyer, maturity and competitiveness are key factors when it comes to appraising whether to buy an MSP business. Because as a buyer, you're really not interested in fixing the MSP, you're interested in growing your business. So purchasers want their cash flow and their profits to continue on in the future the easiest way possible. So the question is, to sell or not sell, to buy or not buy, decisions, decisions. Well, joining me today is the man with the million-dollar name, Mr. Michael Einbinder-Schatz, to talk about life after the acquisition of his MSP, Jobecca Technologies. Welcome, my friend. How are you today?
I'm great, Barb. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, I'm so happy you're doing this. So tell me, like you sold your MSP, like, you know what, tell everyone about you and your MSP and what you did, because your career in the MSP space is legendary. You've been doing it for a very, very long time.
A legend in my own mind. So I fell into the business, first of all. You know, I love to tell people that I stumbled into this after going to film school, because it's true. I didn't know what I wanted to do when I grew up. I had some thoughts about doing something creative. And when I got out of college, the opportunity that I grabbed onto was an opportunity working for a videotape distributor. This is when video stores were huge. And we bought and sold used movies. We also sold new adult films, by the way. So it was an interesting job. And I was strictly in sales. And I convinced myself that that was somehow related to a film degree, which, let me just tell you, it was not. But something interesting happened while I was there, which is that the company computerized. So this is like in 1987. They computerized, and suddenly I found that I had an aptitude for computers. This was an old PIC mini system. Like, I just understood them on some level, and I had only touched a computer a couple of times in college, you know, unless it was like playing Zork or something like that. I just had never imagined being in that kind of a field. But what happened was I started picking up some side gigs where I was helping people on software, you know, mostly understanding how to work with programs. I never did any development myself. And I finally went out on my own for a small bit of time, but then got a job working for one of the three largest law firms in Philadelphia. And I was I was a software trainer. And from there, I got promoted to a network manager. This was back in the netware days. So we were mainframe and netware based. And I was cutting my teeth on that system. I think we had our first NT351 server in there. And let me tell you, I hated that work, because when I was training, I was working with people. And when I was trying to solve computer problems and manage the network, I always had to be in at 2 a.m. because that was the only time you could fix stuff in a loud computer room, because there were always closings and deals. And I just am not good at 2 a.m. when A isn't talking to B. You know, that's like my worst time of day. So I eventually left and went out on my own. But because I had been working for this large law firm and had been in a training position, I had a tremendous number of relationships. And that's like the number one theme in my business life has been the power of these relationships. So, you know, in law firms, it's up or out. If you're not like partnership tracked, you're going to leave or be asked to leave after a very short period of time. So I knew a lot of people who were leaving, going to smaller firms, hanging their own shingles. And I was able to start working with them on smaller projects. And that was back in 19, I think I started in 1995, moonlighting, and I started my business in 96. So again, it just sort of grew organically. It was all based on word of mouth referrals, so on and so forth. I tried a number of things over the year, different types of business groups. Probably the biggest thing that made a difference for me was getting involved in business education, both at the peer group level and marketing group where I met you, you know, real leadership type stuff that got me thinking about business in a whole different way and learning how to understand the financial side of things and the long-term you know, ramifications of strategic and tactical decisions. So that was it. It was a 26-year journey. We grew the business into a seven-figure business. I never got it quite to where I envisioned, but it was a really terrific run. And I will say this, you know, I don't know if you're following up on this, but I believe there are different types of MSPs that sell at different stages of maturity, and each of them can be looked at and treated differently. Mine was, you know, kind of in a mid-tier, if that makes sense.
So many transformations, so many digital transformations from 1987 to 2022, because, you know, you got your dot-com bust in there, mm-hmm. Got various degrees of recession happening in there. You have, you know, gone is the fax machine. Welcome to email, everybody. All of that happening. Like, it's a long, long, long journey. Lots of fun. Like, you know, lots of fun, lots of tears. Those happen too.
Absolutely.
So how did you find, you sold. So, and your MSP is big because majority of them never make it over the $1 million hump. But mm-hmm. I know that you did. Two questions. Why'd you sell and how did you find your buyer?
Great question. So I alluded to this a minute ago. You know, I think MSPs that sell, and this is probably true for businesses in other industries too, they can be at different stages. So, you know, one stage is the business that has really grown, reached certain big objectives, is very attractive to many buyers out there and can realize, you know, a maximum purchase price and whatever that means to them as the individual, you know. On the other end of the scale is a company that's really, really doing poorly, and that's going to be your classic fire sale. And we've both heard of plenty of these types on both sides. You know, we've seen a lot, particularly with the consolidation in the world of the super MSP now. You have these venture-funded MSPs that are buying up some really, really good companies that have achieved objectives and now are getting bought out for top dollar. On the other end, we've known about people for years who have bought out smaller companies that really were just looking to dump and run. They weren't making it. They were barely paying themselves a salary, whatever it is. And I'll just use the term fire sale there. Because they know that there really isn't much to sell. Maybe they're doing all the technical work. They've got one main client or a few, whatever it might be. And then there's this group in the middle that I fit into. And rather than generalize, I'll just talk about my experience, which was we had achieved certain objectives, but I had bigger objectives. And I thought it was going to take about 5 more years to get there. And then in 2021, we had a series of setbacks on the personnel front. Now, I think it's important to throw a caveat in there, which is, if it sounds like I'm complaining or blaming, I am owning this. In other words, the fact that I started to lose employees, all of it falls on me, you know, at the end of the day. Yes, there was the pandemic and burnout and the great resignation. Those are all real things that were happening and have happened and are happening across various industries. But there are things I could have done strategically and tactically over the years that might have buffered myself more. But what I found was happening, Barb, was that I was losing employees on the technical side that had foundational institutional knowledge of our clients. You know, I had the vision for the business, but I fired myself 24 years ago from doing any day-to-day technical work. So my business was really rooted in having amazing, long-tenured engineers. I mean, our primary engineers were 11, 16, and 21 years with us. And in the course of 1 year, they all gave notice. And two of them were, I'm out of this industry. I am so burned out, because they saw the accelerating pace of what was going on in the MSP space. And now the focus on security, and much higher level than when we started, much higher level than it was 5 years ago. So folks didn't want to be necessarily responsible at the same level. And again, I think there's things I could have done to better buffer that. But here's the interesting thing. I didn't lose really any clients during 2021, but I could see it was putting tremendous pressure on me. And I knew that losing the clients would follow. So I could prop it up for a certain amount of time, but I couldn't hire people. The Philadelphia market was brutal. I was bringing in people. People weren't showing up for interviews. People were making 50%, you know, more than what I had been paying, which was a fair wage. But, you know, it really was putting a lot of pressure on things. And I looked at it objectively and I said, you know, what I need to do is, yes, not only protect myself because I've spent 26 years building this business, but I also have to take care of these clients who have entrusted me for many, many years. Our average client retention, Barb, was 19.2 years at the time I sold. So, So that really meant something to me. As I said, I've always been about the people and the relationships, and we all know we have PETA clients and whatnot. But for the most part, I loved my clients. It meant everything to me that they had placed their faith and trust in me. And I felt like I owed it to them to get them connected with a company that could provide an appropriate level of response and service and help them grow and better support them in these, you know, scary times with regard to, you know, cyber threats, compliance, all of that. So that's the lead up to that. And you know me, I'm not pithy. So finding someone was not hard, though. First of all, I mean, I was getting approached all the time. We all are. I'm sure, how many offers a week do you get to have that sit-down conversation? But I wasn't interested in those. I had a couple of serious people approach me. One that was recommended by a mutual friend was one of the super MSPs, and they were, in fact, very close to me physically. You know, they were, I believe they're a nine-figure MSP at this point. So that's, you know, that's the real deal. But I had been in an accountability group with Will Nobles from Vector Choice. I knew him. I trusted him. I felt very comfortable with him. I liked what he was doing with his business. And we started down a path of having conversations about this. And what I liked was that the size of Vector, although growing respectably, was not something that would necessarily be daunting to those clients who were really used to that small personal touch. Wasn't a guarantee we would keep everybody, but I felt like they had a lot more to offer. Because, by the way, in the year of 2021, while I'm juggling all of these changes happening in the business, I'm falling behind a little bit on the cybersecurity side, where I'd always prided myself of being a little ahead of the curve. because there's only so many balls you can keep in the air. Oh, and the final thing, and you know this, I knew that I was having a major surgery in 2022, which I've had, and I'm doing great. But, I needed to take care of the client. So it was really a fairly easy process. I felt and feel like it was a great decision. There was a good merging of cultures. The tools that are used are, you know, in many cases, the tools we used. The support structure has been terrific. And we've retained something like 94% of the recurring revenue clients. We're 11 and a half months in at this point. And many of them have bought new and improved services that better protect their businesses. So, you know, I look at this first year and go, wow, this has been very successful for the clients. And of course, it's worked out well for Vector as well. So I'm happy on all fronts.
So you, Will, and I, we were all in the same marketing and accountability group. So we kind of like, all of us like grew up together in growing of our business, because IT is labor intensive no matter which direction you go into, like, you know, from providing cybersecurity services, the business management of it, dealing with vendors, because we're all reselling tools, and there's so much happening in mergers and acquisitions and staying on top of contracts and staying up to date with compliance and security, everything across the board. It's all changing. I know that for us, we got our CompTIA security trustmark plus accreditation, and that was a big one. It's now becoming a standard. We're the first MSP in Canada to have it.
So, and I know what a big deal that was for you when you were going through it. That was
I cried. I cried when I got the email that says, like, you know what, you got your stamp, you got your approval. It's like, oh my goodness, we did it. Because you worry all the time. So what did you do to, if anything, did you do to prepare your customers for the sale? Like, how did you handle that? Because essentially, we know the buyer's good. We know the processes are good, but the bond is with you for, like, you know what, you're in the business for 26 years. You know what, your average relationship is like, you know, it's hitting the 20-year mark, 19.1 years. How did you prepare your customers for this transition and heartbreak of you moving on?
You know, obviously, first of all, there was no preparation before we dotted the I's and crossed the T's, because, you know, the most important thing that Vector was purchasing was those relationships. You know, in an MSP, I had no intellectual property. You know, I hadn't written the next great software tool or process. And it's not like we had this amazing inventory. It was the clients, the relationships, the recurring revenue, the profitability, that was what it was all about. And me, you know, the relationship piece there. So, you know, Will had a very well-structured plan on how to integrate the businesses, because it wasn't his first rodeo on this. And then we had like just countless meetings with him and myself and his key team members, and we just went through things and checked things off the list and prioritized and brainstormed and dealt with problems and put out fires. But, you know, the early pieces were, there was communication within the first couple of days where you know, I reached out via email and phone calls and follow-up, and then introduced them to Will, who then did his follow-up. Eventually, he came up with his chief operating officer, and, you know, we visited clients together. So there was a lot of work that was done to promote a continuation of trust and comfort. And, you know, that's a tricky thing, you know, because what do you do when it's like you've been used to working with certain people who are in a certain physical location? I mean, we lost one client who really only wants to work with a company that is physically based in Philadelphia. And they were a long-term client and a friend of mine, and they're still friends. You know, I understand this client was very different in the way they think than any other client I've ever had. And I just sort of nodded my head and understood. But, you know, if they were thinking that way, certainly some other clients might have been thinking that way, but not acting that way. And I think the rub was, how do you build enough trust to buy some time and demonstrate that, hey, not only are you going to get the service that you're used to, and of course, there may be some hiccups on the way, and there may be some things where we do things a little differently than we did them before, but how do we demonstrate that we can actually provide you with more value? And that was one of the things I saw at Vector, because they were a more mature and larger organization, was that we could provide them with more, our clients with more value. So the conversations I was having, and I basically was working full-time in this right up until my surgery, which was August, the beginning of August, was every conversation was about demonstrating increased value, not the same value, increased value.
So how, what did those conversations look like? Because I've gone through acquisitions myself and experienced the same, and being on this side of the equator, like, you know, being from Canada, when acquired an American company, all of a sudden they're just like, we know it well, we're American, like, you know what, like, you know, we're, it's like, okay, all right, so what do I do here? Because as they're saying, we don't want to deal with Canadians, we want to stay, you know what, shop local, buy local, they're staying local. So my solution was like, okay, well, we're going to open a small subsidiary office in the US to have an American presence there. So how did you, because you already provided great value. People stayed with you for 19 years because you provided them great value. What did you do to level them up with more great value?
Well, remember I said that in 2021, as we were dealing with the stresses on the business, I felt like we were slipping a little behind in terms of cyber compliance, so on and so forth. So I felt that day one, right out of the gate, I felt that Vector Choice provided a more robust stack than my company, Jobecca, was providing. And I felt that was really important. Not that the clients had to buy that right away, but they needed to know that that was on the table, that the game was changing, that the threats were becoming more and more serious, and the rules and guidelines were changing in various industries, depending on, you know, what sector they were in. So if there were already many things that they were doing that 5 years, 10 years, 15 years ago, they had never thought about, right? I mean, I always would joke, you know, I mean, when I started the business, you threw on Norton antivirus, it updated virus signatures once every 2 weeks or once every month, and you know, you were good to go. And then it's like, you know, yeah, do you need antivirus now? Of course you do, but would you trust your system security to just having an antivirus product that can't possibly keep up with the number of threats that are being released every single day? Of course not. So you need this multi-layered approach. And the layers are growing, and you need a company that has the resources to devote to all the necessary testing and keeping abreast of what's going on in the industry. And frankly put, my company losing key people was losing that ability. I was the one that went to the majority of the industry events, and I would come back with great ideas. And you know this, Barb, because we're at a lot of these events together. You see some great things. But just because I saw it and I saw some great channel partner pitching it doesn't mean it's the right solution. So somebody's got to test it and somebody's got to make some recommendations. And, you know, we had product champions at Jobecca, just like mature MSPs do, and say, okay, this fits in this space, and that's going to get handed out to this person. And they would test a few things, and then we would make recommendations to our clients as to what next year's stack was going to look like. So I, right out of the gate, Vector had a better stack, and we were able to have that future forward-facing conversation. But Will was also working really hard on building up a compliance practice, which is, you know, people think security and they think compliance, and isn't that all part of the same thing? Well, I guess it's part of the same thing in the same way that people think that because they're paying someone to do remote monitoring and management, that the MSP is then responsible for doing everything on their system, which is a long-winded way of saying they are not the same thing. And you need a company that's robust and mature enough to recognize that. And so, again, those conversations, there was a lot of hand-holding, but there was a lot of guiding them gently into this is the way it's going to be. And whatever choices you make as a business in terms of what level of support you want, you're going to want to be aligned with a company that's doing this. Because look, there's plenty of break fix providers out there. You want to save money and make this easy peasy, pick up the phone when there's a problem and somebody comes out, you call the Geek Squad, whatever it is. You know, that'll always be available, but that's, is that going to be enough to try to take care of your business?
It always reminds me of that meme, like, you know what, like the budget before an incident, like, you know, mm-hmm. what, and people are like moving pennies, and then after it happens, they're just like, you know what, can I how much can I give you, and if I gave it to you faster, could you get it done sooner? Because it's all about prevention. It's all about I don't want to say segregation, but when you get into higher level securities, much as a building has a key pass and fob to get into different areas and people can access, it's the exact same thing behind the scenes in these devices with keyboards to keep everyone safe. The challenge is, you know, out of sight, out of mind. And when something comes to surface, it's a problem. So you never want it to come to surface and boil over. Like, you know what, you have your different thresholds, like, you know, like good, critical, like danger, you're going to blow. And essentially when the problems are peaking, there's a lot of trouble there. And when that happens, because it does, that's when you reach out to an MSP and then you realize after the fact, it would have been a hell of a lot cheaper, more pragmatic, less stressful if you started there in the first place to stay organized with everything. So any regrets selling?
Do I have any regrets selling? No, I have no regrets selling. I absolutely made the right move in selling the business. My recovery, although going very well, has taken longer than I would have expected. And I need the freedom that that has bought me. And, you know, you work a long time in building something up. Again, I didn't get it to the level I wanted, but I got it to a level where I could do that. And I'm very grateful.
You got it to a level that is greater than 99% of most MSPs out there. You might not think that because I know that you're very humble and things
I'm driven to. I wanted more. I wanted more, damn it. but yes, you know, I know that only, I believe it's only 4% of MSPs at the time we cracked the seven figure, only 4% were hitting that level. I don't know if that's 100% accurate. I haven't done my research on it because while it was important to me that we hit that as a milestone, I wasn't researching what other companies were doing in that regard.
So what are you doing now? You sold? Mm-hmm. You got, the I's have been dotted, the T's have been crossed, the paperwork has been signed, you met with all of your customers, you know, you're taking care of your health, your family, like what are What are you doing now? Because I don't think you're fully retired just yet.
No. I'm not fully retired. So first of all, you know, one component, and just because I know that there'll be people listening on both sides of the aisle on this, people who are buyers and people who are sellers or people who are thinking of doing one of those, you know, acquiring a company or selling their company maybe for the first time. It's important to note, I mean, there's lots of different ways that these deals can be structured. So one component, again, as I stressed earlier, what was being purchased here, the primary thing was the relationships that I had with these clients. These clients were the deal. So part of my deal, and I think you would find this very often, is that there is a structured earnout period that's based on retention. So like, boom, laser focused, retain and grow the existing clients. I spent about 7 months working on that. During that time, we worked hard on transitioning them to a Vector's model, which is focused around, you know, primary point of contact being a client relationship manager. And Vector has some really good client relationship managers. I mean, frankly, they've got tremendous energy and are able to make things happen in a way that is inspiring at times. And so it wasn't just working with the clients to show that they should have continued trust and faith in me, because long term, whatever I end up doing, I'm not the be all and end all. You know, my phone can't be ringing because you're having trouble printing, you know, and it's not that it rang at Jobecca, but you know, again, I was the failsafe, right? And I cannot be the failsafe forever in this case. You know, I continue to work with Vector. We're talking about different roles. I'm going to be functioning in some sort of a, what's the term that I want to say for this? A fractional role to help them. You know, I remain committed to helping them with any clients that need assistance in terms of applying my own unique touch, while also not causing the problems that can come with that, if you know what I mean. And then by problems, I just mean too much reliance on the old way. You know, sometimes you have to, there's a point you have to rip the Band-Aid off. And I partnered with a company that has great support structures so that we could rip that Band-Aid off. I am looking at a number of different things, but I'll tell you, 2023 is going to be focused. I have some really fun travel plans. We're planning on taking a long trip to Europe that's been in the works for a few years, and pushed back due to the pandemic. So now, you know, I think there's a good chance we're going to be away for like 6 weeks, and it's going to be nice to have that. It's also nice to know that I can work while I'm away, you know? I mean, that's one thing that this technology provides us the opportunity to do. I'm looking at some other opportunities in terms of sharing my knowledge of business and 26 years and lessons learned and leadership and so on and so forth, professional development. And another thing that's completely different, but I think you may know this, but I've attended some events that were hosted, professional development events hosted by Jack Canfield. Are you familiar with Jack?
No.
So Jack was one of the writers, publishers of the Chicken Soup for the Soul series. And, you know, he is one of the great professional development and personal development leaders out there. I think, you know, he's incredibly genuine. And I mean, they had to take their original book to 144 publishers. And like a lot of people that have, quote unquote, made it, you know, that perseverance, that belief in self leads to some pretty powerful life lessons. He has a philosophy called the Success Principles. None of them he's created. They're all borrowed from other sources he's learned over the years, which is what everybody does, even the Tony Robbins of the world. You know, they're taking great ideas and finding ways to present them, not as in I invented this, but as in I have a great way of presenting information that can make a difference in your life, whatever that might be. So I'm going to be absolutely working on becoming certified success principles coach. I don't know what that's going to lead to, and I don't really care. It doesn't matter because it's personal growth and knowledge. And I just, you know, frankly, Barb, I love that stuff. And I think I can bring all of that to bear in being in service to individuals and businesses at some point down the road. So is that vague and specific enough?
Yes, that's awesome. Because I feel that when you're in IT, you know so much about business and how the wheels churn, because everybody is looking to digitalize things, to automate things. And after 26 years, the wheel has already been invented. And it's now, how do you use this wheel? How do you leverage this wheel and apply it to keep whatever it is that you're working on in your business moving forward in a positive direction?
Right.
And then you have to couple that with emotional intelligence, as much as you have to couple it with communication skills.
Correct.
Because when you're in IT, it is labor intensive. It is mentally intensive, emotionally intensive, financially intensive. And you have to figure out that journey. And once you've gone through the journey, like you have, and come out the other end, and you have a solid business that you can sell, that now you can keep your life personally moving forward in a positive direction, that's an accomplishment and it feels good. And the best way to give back is to give back, whether it's in a fractional role, a consultative role, because after 26 years, honest to God, you've seen a lot of shit and it's not new. It's not new. So knowing how to deal it, deliver it, package it, what works, what not works. You know what? You can write case studies galore and they can just be your personal diary from all the things that you had to like deal with in your IT career.
Well, and again, I think, you know, with my skill set being more on the personal level, it's like you talk about case studies. The truth of the matter is, who reads that? I know you probably do, but you know. but all kidding aside, I think there are people taking information in different ways. And so I'm going to connect with a certain group of people who are going to take it in, you know, via presentations, via consultative approach, whatever it might be. And it doesn't have to be in the IT space, although I do have something specific to offer there. One of the things I like about the success principles is that they are lessons for helping anybody, really. You know, I mean, I just want to be clear when I talk about Jack Canfield, I'm not talking about some cult. I mean, this is someone who, you know, basically appropriated information that he's learned over the years and found a great way to present it. And his goal is to help, you know, a million people be able to present this. My wife is already certified. She wants to take this and bring it to school districts, because she is recently retired as a teacher. So she wants to find ways to teach educators to help teach kids how to, you know, the number one success principle is you take 100% responsibility for everything that happens in your life or how you react to the events in your life. So if a kid at age 10 can learn that because they're being taught that, you know, rather than being entitled and complaining about everything and nothing's their fault, we can make a better society. Just kind of makes sense. And if we can do that in business too, instead of bitching and moaning about the client this and the vendor this and go, well, what role did I play? That's why I said to you, you know, I could go on and on about the great resignation and that stuff was all real. But it's like, how did I respond to that? Does that make sense?
I get it. Like, you know, I get it very much so. And it's all part of growth and evolution. And it keeps the choices that we make keeps us moving forward in a positive direction. So on that note, I'm going to Clint Arthur you. Are you ready for this?
Sure.
What is the most important thing you have ever learned?
I think I can give you, would it be all right if I say there are two that are equally important? Or yes. Can I only give you one? All right.
You can say two.
Okay, good. So the first one is one that I learned from the first business coach I ever hired way back in 2006, a man by the name of Scott Messer. And he drew this diagram. We were having lunch at like our first meeting, and he took, and this was at a diner. So it had one of those placemats that had advertisements all over it for lawyers and accountants. And he flipped it over to the blank side, and he drew three concentric circles. And in the inside one, he wrote comfort. And in the middle one, he wrote uncomfortable. And in the outer one, he wrote fear. And he talked about how we need to learn how to exist outside of our comfort zone. We don't have to live outside of there. It's about taking these little forays and doing things that make you uncomfortable just for a little bit, and then going back in. And what you learn over a little bit of time is, oh, that didn't kill me, right? I could do something that makes me uncomfortable. And then the next thing that happens is that comfort zone grows a little bit. I'm doing that poorly, but it grows a little bit. And so now what was in there, what was uncomfortable before, some of those things are now part of the comfort zone because you've built that experience. And the things that were scary, the outermost, now they're uncomfortable. Because you've built stuff where, well, that's not so scary, but it's uncomfortable. But the horizon always moves. It never ends, right? So now there's a new group of things that come and fill the fear. What's cool about it is that those are things you never even thought about before, because they were just outside of your worldview. So now you can think, oh, I could never do that. And that was something you weren't even thinking about. And if you think about our industry, Barb, that's like we are now doing things that if we had thought about them 10 years ago, 5 years ago, in some case, 20 years ago, would have scared the shit out of us, right? How could we ever, deal with compliance, right? But we learn how to do other things. It builds up to that. And now that becomes part of our comfort zone, or maybe for other MSPs, it's just uncomfortable, So that's the number one thing. I think it applies to all things in life. The other one is what I mentioned earlier, and that's taking 100% responsibility for everything that happens to you in your life or how you respond to it. And people get a little stuck on this, they go, how can I be responsible for the piano that fell on my head while I was walking down the street? Well, you can't. Like a piano falling out of the sky and hitting you on the head is not something you're responsible for in the classic sense. But you are responsible for how you respond to that. And the best story I've ever thought of for this involves a local radio personality here in the Philadelphia area by the name of Dan Gottlieb. In the early or mid 70s, Dan was driving on the Pennsylvania Turnpike, which has a concrete divider between the different directions, when a truck lost its tire, like a blowout or something on the other side. And that tire came over the divider, went through the windshield, hit him, and made him a quadriplegic. Now, Dan was a psychologist at the time, and he went through all the classic symptoms that people go through when they have a sudden traumatic injury like this. Suicidal thoughts, deep, severe depression. I can't even. But eventually, like, he realized, like, I still have something to say. I still can make a difference. And he went back into practice and ultimately started a very successful radio show called Voices in the Family, that ran and may still be on the radio. I listen to podcasts now, so I'm in the Philadelphia area, but he's helped thousands of people over the decades, probably more, with his show, where he interviews people, he has people call in, because he decided to take this situation that happened to him and respond differently to it. than a lot of people would. So I'll leave you on that with that thought.
Wow. Wow. Your career and your life has evolved so beautifully. And you're now at the stage where you can grow other people to be as successful as you, Mr. Michael Einbinder-Schatz. And I mean that in the best way, because if you think about it, started in 1987, you know what, went through a digital transformation, tech turn, owner, operator, grew a business, you know what, hit the seven-figure mark, which is lovely, came full circle, sold a profitable business, helped another business grow. Now you get to focus on you, your family, and helping others move forward in a positive direction. Like that's a beautiful story. It truly is. I'm always thankful for all the help that you've given me as CDN Technologies has grown over the years. Like it's great having you as a resource and to help other people. And so I have to say thank you for all the things that you've shared with me and CDN Technologies and all of our listeners out there, because we got a good little pocket here in Southern Ontario. And plus there's the channel and all the other people that we know through the various seminars that we've attended to and the different growth strategies that we've implemented into our business. And at CDN Technologies, we have a growth strategy, a growth through acquisition strategy, where we create opportunities for small owners of MSP businesses, whether they want to retire or move out of the sector, we can help. And thank you to CDN Technologies for bringing us this podcast. CDN Technologies is your outsourced IT company where we provide IT service, IT support, and cybersecurity from our Oakville office, our worldwide headquarters of Oakville, Ontario. CDN Technologies has been doing IT since 1989, and we support companies of all shapes and sizes because technology and threats change daily. So shift the stress of managing your technology to CDN Technologies, as we're direct to tech 24/7, 365, and our mission is to bring you user-friendly, hands-free technology peace. Call us 905-542-9759 or visit us at cdntechnologies.com.